Engine swaps are certainly nothing new, but behind us we've got Chris Alexander's R32 Nissan GTR with certainly an engine swap that I've never seen, and definitely nothing I've seen here at World Time Attack. We're here with Dom from Tony Rigoli Performance to talk a little bit about this car. So for a start, there's no RB in this car anymore. What's it got?
It's a 4G63, like an Evo 9 engine.
Okay, that on face value would seem to be an unusual choice. I mean, obviously the RB26, RB28, 30, all of the different variations we see make amazing power, and power is really critical here at World Time Attack. So on face value, going to a smaller capacity four-cylinder engine might seem like an unusual choice. Why did you do that?
We've done it to pull weight out of the front end to make the car corner better. As for the power, we can make the power out of one of these engines basically the same as a six-cylinder, because you are limited to turbo size for it to be responsive, you know. So yeah, the RB can make big power with a massive turbo on it, but on the same turbo, you know, this little thing does all right.
It does all right. We'll talk about the power shortly. So, you know, basically being that the four-cylinder is obviously so much shorter, it's not just the mass of the engine that's important. It's the fact that it's not so far out over the front axle line. Is that correct?
That's correct, yeah.
And we can see visually just how far back in the engine bay the engine is. Now, I believe you also have a rule where you have to retain the factory firewall. Is that the limiting factor for where you can position the engine?
Yeah, that's correct, yeah.
Okay, so when it comes to 4G63s, well, actually it's come back a step. Obviously, when you're looking at going to a four-cylinder engine, there are a lot of options out there, and we continually get pummeled on the internet for not putting a K-Series into our own 86 race car. So why was the 4G63 the obvious option?
A Honda, I couldn't do it to Chris. I couldn't do it to myself. But yeah, no, the 4Gs, we've done a lot of development, you know, over the years, so That's why that was our choice of engine.
You've stuck to something that you know inside and out, and you know you can produce the power reliably.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
And I mean, I think that's important to understand as well. Yes, there's probably a half a dozen other engines that could do what you're doing with this. You don't need to go and relearn everything about a new engine that you're not familiar with, which is so valuable in terms of time and money spent.
Yeah, it is, you know, and we have a lot of parts for this, you know, so it wouldn't make sense to go with a different engine again.
All right, so the engine, and I'm going to come back and talk a little bit more about it, but it's not just the mass of the engine that you've changed in this car in order to get the handling or the weight balance a little bit improved over where it was. What have you got in the way of a transmission now, or transaxle specifically?
Now it runs the Albans ST6 transaxle.
Okay, so for those who aren't aware, tell us what the difference between a transaxle and a conventional transmission is.
So the gearbox in this car used to be in the front, bolted to the back of the engine. Now the whole unit's in the back, gearbox, clutch, alternator, starter motor, so everything's in the back of the car.
So essentially you're just running a prop shaft that rotates at engine speed through the transmission tunnel, and everything else is at the rear, or do you still have a clutch and flywheel on the actual engine?
No, well, the clutch, flywheel, everything's in the rear. So at the front it just has like a coupler, just so we can connect the shaft. So basically like an R35.
And what sort of advantage does that give in terms of the weight balance? Do you actually have numbers on that yet, or is it too early to really know?
Yeah, look, we only just finished the car, so we barely had time to put doors and a front end on it. So, but yeah, it's the balance will be a lot better. Like everyone always wants more weight to the centre of the car, you know, and that's basically what it's done.
Yeah, I think there's a couple of elements that are important to mention here, and the first is you showed me off camera a photo of the car essentially as a bare chassis and roll cage, and that was only 3 weeks ago. So I'll give you a bit of a free kick there for maybe not having a thorough understanding of everything that's done. That obviously will come with time, but coming back to the weight and the position of the weight, it's not just the weight that's important, it's trying to get that weight more towards the centre of the car, and that will help allow the car to rotate better than if we've got weight right at the extremities of the car, correct?
Yes. So when this thing had the RB26 in it with the all-wheel drive, you got all that diff and shafts and turning into a corner fast, it's always going to push on the front end. Whereas now it'll be a lot better turning in. You won't have that drag.
All right, let's come back to that engine. And when it comes to producing huge numbers with the 4G63, just like almost every engine that's out there now, there are billet options available. And you haven't gone that route. Do you just feel that it's not necessary at your power level?
Yeah, it's not. I mean, we can run these up to 1600 horsepower, like in a drag application. So at the power this is running on, you know, there isn't an issue.
And there's a range of different options when it comes to engine combos for the 4G. There's the 4G64, there's 2.1 long rod engines, the list goes on. What have you chosen in terms of an engine combination for this?
It's a 2.2 litre, like it's our own stroker kit, so iron rod length piston combo, but the block is just factory 4G63.
Why the 2.2 compared to the 2.4? What's your reasoning there? Why do you favour that instead of a little bit more capacity?
What I've found with the 2.4s is that they really hit a brick wall with RPM. They do make a little bit more torque, but the 2.2 is a very happy medium when you're looking at between a 2 litre to a 2.4.
Okay, and in terms of revs, what are you revving it to?
The limiter now set at 92, so you hit it a couple of times and we'll probably end up lifting it.
It's still making power out there?
Yeah.
And in terms of power, what are you making and what sort of boost pressure are you using to make that power?
At 45 pounds, it makes 1,030 at the hub.
It's pretty solid for a small capacity engine. What turbo are you using to get that?
It's the Borg Warner 9280, the EFR.
And what sort of, I mean, that's a big turbo for a 2.2 litre engine. What sort of RPM are you starting to see at producing decent boost?
They normally come on, this thing would be coming on really strong around the 4,500.
That's an impressive response. In terms of the engine, you mentioned it is MIVEC or variable cam control. So you're still retaining the cam control. A lot of people go away from that with bigger cams because they can't swing the cam.
Yeah, we run the custom grime cam and it's running the cam control as well.
So is that pretty critical to getting that lower RPM boost response?
It is, because you can set the cam where you want it to have plenty of torque.
One of the problems with any high boost engine, the 4G is not immune to it, is head gasket integrity. Can you let us in on what you're using to seal the head to the block?
Yeah, we run like a fire ring setup with a copper gasket, so it's like a alloy bronze ring.
So that just seals, the ring sits on the top of the bore. I believe you probably have a groove that it steps into at the top of the bore, and then it seals straight to the head?
Yeah, and it's just as flat on the head. So.
And then the copper gasket there is essentially just for sealing water and oil?
Yeah, that's correct.
Now, one of the problems with those copper gaskets, I mean, they're very popular for high boost applications, but they don't do a real good job of actually sealing the oil and water, do they? What do you do in order to stop it actually leaking?
We use 3-bond, like use a good 3-bond, and that's a fine line of using not enough or too much.
Because you don't want that 3-bonds getting into places that it shouldn't be, but obviously you want it to do the sealing job.
That's right, yeah.
All right, in terms of the rest of the package, can we talk a little bit about the electronics? So what have you got managing everything in the car?
Yeah, the EMtron KV16 manages all the engine stuff, and then it runs like a MoTeC Dash, MoTeC PDM.
The MoTeC Dash for logging hub and driver display?
Yeah, that's correct, yeah.
Scott at EMtron has been beavering away pretty seriously at World Time Attack developing the EMtron product, and he's doing a lot around torque management and basically allowing these cars to put a lot of power to the track. And something we haven't touched on here, which probably should have been obvious, is it's no longer four-wheel drive either, like a conventional R32 GTR. Rear-wheel drive only. So can you talk to us a little bit about the strategies in terms of optimizing the torque that the engine's producing and how much you can get to the track?
Yeah, look, the torque modeling traction control obviously retards timing, and it's got ignition cuts, and however he does it, that's his deal. But on the car now, like, it's still too early. We're still setting suspension. Like, he has started loading stuff in, but we're just sort of going as we go.
Now, another aspect you just mentioned there was suspension, and I don't believe this is a new addition, but if we look at the front suspension setup, it is drastically different to a conventional R32 GTR. One of the rules, again, with the class you're running in, you have to retain the factory strut tower, but we've got no strut there anymore, and it's got a sort of a rocker arrangement, inboard suspension, anti-roll bar that is in the scuttle panel at the base of the windscreen. What's the impetus around that change?
All that stuff is way over my head. I'm a drag racer. But yeah, like, when the car was built, they've done that for geometry for some kind of reason.
Fair enough. You're a drag racer. You're there to make a lot of power with the engine, and we can respect that. We don't have to know every element of the car.
Yeah, but honestly, I don't know why it's like that. I know it has something to do with the car being very low, and where the shocks need to be.
Fair enough. I mean, generally as well, a lot of the elements with the suspension on these cars producing huge downforce, as well as maintaining, keeping the car actually off the track at 270 kilometres an hour coming into turn one. So I can't speak for that on this particular car, but we'll move on anyway. Domlo, it's been great to get some insight into certainly one of the more unique builds I've seen over the years we've been coming to World Time Attack. Obviously, as you mentioned, early days for the car. I'm sure once you get it dialed in, it's going to be incredibly competitive, and we wish you all the best for the rest of the weekend.
Yeah, thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.